Good morning. Welcome to North Baptist Church this morning for our morning service. If you would, please stand with me. We're going to start with hymn number 573, Heaven Came Down. Follow me on this one. We're going to speed it up just a little bit there. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shed his dispelling with joy, I am telling, he made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and joy refilled my soul. Cross my Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. That will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believed. Riches eternal and blessed, supernal, from his precious hand I received. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, filled my soul. Thank you. Please remain standing for prayer.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to North Baptist Church. I'd like to thank you all for being here today. At this time, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you bless us with. You. We thank you that the sun is shining and that we're able to be in here filled with joy in your house. Pray that you'd be with any of those who aren't able to be here, that you'd be with them wherever they may be. Bless them this morning. I pray that you'd be with our service, that everything done here is honoring and glorifying to you, that you'd give passion to the words to say, and us open words and open hearts to whatever it is you have for us. In your name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
Okay, for our next hymn, it will be up on the screen for us, and we'll see how it goes. We'll do the first three verses. I still have a little tickle in my throat. I'm a little bit more here vocally than I was a week ago. But the singing brings out something. I don't know. I'll let you remain seated for this one, okay? Go ahead. Let's try this again. Arise, my soul, arise. Shake off thy guilty fears. The blessing sacrifice in my behalf appears. Before the throne my surety stands. Before the throne my surety stands. My name is written.
Thank you for that, choir. Good morning once again. If you're a first-time visitor, there should be a welcome card on the seat in front of you. If you've not received one, we'll get you one afterwards, but there should be one on the seat in front of you. If you could fill that out and drop it in the offering plate as it passes in just a few moments. We have just a few announcements at this time. First one being, it is the beginning of a new month, so we have added another missionary to our ring. This month we have Wesley and Sonia Chatla, so please make sure to add that to your ring. I believe it's in the same spot in the corner still, but if you would be so kind as to grab one of those, add it to your ring, and remember them in prayer throughout this month, as well as the rest of them who should be on your ring as well. With the beginning of the new year, we talked about a couple different ladies' Bible studies that are coming up. Those will be starting tomorrow morning. That one will be from 9:30 to 11 with Miss Linda Nealis as the teacher, and that one will be the End Times in Chronological Order. And that one will meet every Monday starting tomorrow, January 7th. And then the next one is going to be the very next day, January 8th. That one will meet every second Tuesday of the month. That one is taught by Miss Susan Burkholder. And that one will be in the evening from 6 to 7:15. And that one is titled Walking with God. So if you'd like to join either of those classes, you can sign up at the Welcome Center. I saw the sign-up sheets. There seem to be quite a few people signed up, so that's encouraging to see. But if you would like to join, there's still time. You have any time you want. But they're starting tomorrow and then Tuesday. So please sign up for that and be here for that. Again, with the new year, there's going to be many new things coming up, so keep your ears open to those. The teen center, or the youth center, whatever you'd like to call it, is now finished. Special thanks to Laverne and Bob Buckley and anyone else who I might miss who helped out. We as the teens, obviously all of us, we really appreciate it. It looks real good. So if you'd like to get out there and take a look, maybe Wednesday or sometime, it'll be open then. And the teens will start meeting in there next Sunday, well, Wednesday, but also for Sunday school starting next Sunday morning. At this time, the gentleman would like to come forward to take the offering. Junior churchers, if you would like to be dismissed after we start the next song after the offering, you may do so during the first verse of that. Brother Russ Jack, would you bless our offering? Thank you.
appreciate that. Let's stand and turn to hymn number 46. We're going to sing verses 1 and 3 of This Is My Father's World before the pastor comes forth a message this morning.
Good morning, everybody. Isn't this great to be here the first Sunday of 2019? How many are glad you're here? Well, okay. Who didn't raise your hand? It is good to be here. How many of you know what this is up here in this seat? What do you think this is? Anybody? Home plate. Well, that's pretty good. Tom, what is this? It's a home plate. What's the purpose of a home plate? To be home. Home run. Well, okay, that's good. Now tell me folks, what good does this do for a pitcher? Tom, can you tell us? Yeah. In other words, he's got to pitch the ball right here over the plate. Is that correct? Do you know how wide this is? Do you know how wide this is? Who said that? Debbie Burner. Okay, Debbie Burner. How wide is this? How do you know? She's heard stories. Okay. I just thought I'd find out if you guys knew what that was. Don't worry about it. It'll be there at the end of the message. You'll say, what purpose does that have with the message? Well, hang around and you'll find out, okay? We'll get busy. Hey, listen, by the way, starting in the new year here, we are going to have a ladies' Bible study each Monday morning at 9 o'clock. Is that right? 9:30. Who said 9? Oh, Linda. Linda. Linda Nealis is teaching it. You would know what time it would start, right? 9:30, right? On Monday mornings. But also on Tuesday mornings at... Calm down, Susan. I'm getting there. On Tuesday mornings at 10 o'clock, I had Susan worried. At 10 o'clock Tuesday mornings, ladies' prayer. Okay? Kathy Jacka wanted me to announce that. We want to encourage you ladies to come at 10 o'clock on Tuesday mornings. Is that okay, dear? All right. Led by Kathy Jacka. Then on Tuesday mornings at 9 o'clock. Men, let's come together and pray. Now, I know a lot of you work. A lot of you, your wives have you working. Okay, that's understandable. But we want to encourage the men at 9 o'clock on Tuesday mornings to come. Russ Jacka will lead that. Let's get some men. Let's come and let's pray. Let's have a time of prayer, all right? Then, on the second Tuesday night of each month, is this right? Okay. At the second Tuesday of each month, Susan's going to lead a Bible study from 6:15, from 6 to 7:15. Okay. You see how I can keep everything straight? I just make sure my wife's down front here to coach me, all right? You don't know it, but she's got cue cards, all right? And Susan is going to do a particular study. Well, she's going to do several things. But it's our walk with God. And then Linda is doing some prophecy. So this ought to interest you. So please take note of that. And let's come and support these things, because we certainly, more than ever, need prayer, don't we? And we need to be in the Word. We want to make 2019 a good year. You guys want 2019 to be a good year, right? Don't you? For some of you, it might mean that you find the one and only. You find that one you've been praying for. Guys, you find that girlfriend, or girls, you get that boyfriend. Or maybe not. I don't know. For some of you, it might be that this is the year I pay my house off. Well, that would be nice. Or this is the year I pay this bill off, or whatever it may be. For some of you, it could be the year you go home. You just don't know. Be a good idea to be prepared and ready. Amen. That's right. I want to help you. Haven't we had some wonderful weather the last 3 days? Up in the 40s, one day 48, sunny. Isn't today beautiful? Well, you're welcome. You're welcome, folks. I wanted to do what I could. My snow blower is working. I told you that once I bought that, I'd never have to. I told Susan, I said, never have to use it. But I've taken care of winter. Now, am I not good on my word, or am I not good? Thank you. Donna says I look good. Oh, well, okay, I'm sorry. Scratch that, I look good, all right? Well, I tell you what, you know as well as I do that whatever I bought or didn't buy, it had nothing to do with the weather. We're just thanking the Lord for good weather. But I do want to help you. I do have something. I think I can help you guys. I can help you make 2019 a great year. Would you like to know how? All right, let's find out. Would you go to Philippians chapter 4? Now, we're going to start here. We'll end up here. However, I want to help you have the right disposition, the right attitude, the right mood, the right spirit. I want you to have the right viewpoint. I want you to have the right outlook on life and on the challenges that will come your way. Here's one thing that's guaranteed, folks, and that is, and this is maybe prophetical, but you will face some problems. Now, you just might as well mark that down. You're going to face some problems. You could face problems at the house. You know, the heater goes out, the air goes out, the water. Something happens that a water line bursts or something, or tree falls. Oh, a lot of things. It could be finances. It could be health. It could be a neighbor. It could be a number of things. I do think that we're headed for some very troubled waters in our country. And I do think that when you have congressmen and women, you have senators and representatives that don't know how to curb their tongue to use the filthy foul language they have, we're in trouble. That is for sure. We're in trouble. But that's okay. I don't care. I'm concerned. I care, of course. But in one respect, if you can understand what I'm saying, let the world go to pot. That's okay. God's still on the throne. I still have something worth living about. And remember this, that you think things are so bad. Go back and read some history about what the first century Christians had to endure under the Roman Empire. And you're going to find out that we don't have it quite so bad as we thought. Be thankful that you are here in America instead of Iraq or in Iran or the Sudan. I mean, we have people that are literally giving their lives and being tortured to death for their faith. Thank goodness we're not there yet. We might be. We don't know. But it doesn't matter. We still have something worth living for. Do we not? We have a great God. And I think that if first century Christianity could thrive like it did, that even under the severest of persecution, mightily grew the word of God and prevailed, it can do so here. We still have a message. It doesn't matter how bad things get. We still have a mandate that we have to fulfill. Do you understand that we are still responsible for that? We are still going to be held accountable. Well, Lord, I couldn't because times were so tough. Doesn't matter. I remember things my grandmother Burkholder would tell me about back during the Depression. They survived and came through, and so can we. But let's see, what can we do? Here are some things I want to give you today that will help you. Look at Philippians chapter 4. Look at verse 8. Finally, my brother. Now we're in this text, and we're talking about how important it is to have a healthy church and healthy ministry. I'm trying to impress upon you folks how important it is to have a healthy Christian life, all right? And in these verses here in chapter 4, we've been talking about what helps develop a good disposition. You want a healthy church, don't you? Of course, you know, really, is that a fair question to ask? Do you folks want a good, strong, healthy church? I mean, oh, Brother Burkholder, what do you expect us to say? No, I don't. Well, that's kind of one of those close-ended questions that you ask, and, well, of course you do, of course. But sometimes we don't realize the challenges that we are going to be up against in order for that to become true. But you have to remember now, the church can only be as strong as the individuals in it. If you're not growing in the Lord, if you're not walking with the Lord, if your relationship with the Lord is not strong, if you're not in God's Word, you're going to suffer for it. And if you suffer for it, your family's going to suffer for it. If you're not where you should be, neither will your kids. And if your family's not going to be, the church won't be where it should be. So it's important that we understand this about health. Now, you know, we have to do two things. Life has two sides to it. It's got the physical side, the worldly side. And by that, when I say worldly, I don't mean carnal and ugly and evil, even though it is, but I'm talking about the normal worldly physical life we live. Commerce, business, home, dealing with life, health, things like that. That's one side. Our health, I mean, do you want to have a good life? Well, then you're going to have to keep yourself healthy. You're going to have to do things that are necessary to have good health. That's why Susan all the time wants me to eat more and more vegetables. And I'm trying. Now, there's nothing better than asparagus if it's battered and deep fried. I'm telling you. I eggplant? No. But now, the way she cuts it and batters it and fries it? Okay. I mean, nothing beats good fried food. You know that. Well, that's not really essential for good health. So you do have to watch yourself that way. But we have the other side of life, and that's the spiritual side. Sometimes some of you guys have done great with your finances and your retirement and your savings, but you haven't done too much about your spiritual life. So, you know, there's two sides of life that we need to consider. So we're gonna step on down the passage. We're gonna step over verses 6 and 7 for now. We'll get back to that next week, how important that is. But let's look at verse 8. Finally, my brethren, he says, whatsoever things, all the things that are. Now stop right there, are. We could put a colon there. Things that are essential. Things that are very important. And then he gives us a list. He says, whatsoever things are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, things of good report, if there's any virtue, praiseworthy things. What is the last phrase say? Look at it. Last four words of verse 8. Think on these things. Okay, I want to give you some things to think about. Now, folks, my job as a pastor, I shouldn't say job, it is, but I don't want to look at it like that. My ministry is to feed the flock, to build the flock up. I want to equip the flock. Now, to do that, sometimes I have to be kind of rough, because Paul told Timothy, preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season, be consistent there. Now, that's something for you to think about. You want a good 2019? Then you're going to have to be consistent with your faith. Okay? Be instant, in season, out of season. Preach the word, reprove, rebuke, exhort. Now, we all like the exhorting. We like the encouraging. But sometimes the preacher has to rebuke and reprove. And some of you are going to like it. Some of you are going to like some of the things I say. I will say this. I think some of you will not like some of the stuff that I'm going to say. Some of you, for lunch, you're going to have roasted preacher. How could he start meddling like he does? How could that preacher say that? Who does he think he is? Happens all the time. I think there's some things some of you will not like. And I hope not, but you may take offense at. I don't mean it that way. Please understand that. But I want you to think on some things. Do you know, in this coming year on Sunday mornings, as we talk about a good, strong, healthy church, do you know one of the things we're going to talk about? We're going to talk about stewardship. Oh, I know what you're thinking right now. You're thinking, here we go. He's going to start getting on about money. No, I didn't say money. Did I say money? I didn't say money. I said stewardship. Stewardship has nothing to do with money. Stewardship is management. And if you are properly managing your finances, you'll give to God. Money's a part, but stewardship isn't just money. I'm not going to talk about money. I'm going to talk about giving. And I'm going to encourage people to give. I'm going to tell you why to give, and I'm going to tell you what's in store for you if you fail to give what belongs to God. I know there's this grace of giving, and I'm afraid that some of this concept of this grace of giving is kind of going to an extreme and getting distorted. Grace giving doesn't mean, well, if I just happen to have it this week. Do you know why some of you may not be good at giving? It's because you have so entangled yourself in your budget, you are so stressed and strapped out, you can't. But if you manage right, you can give to God. And another thing that we're going to do is we're going to talk and we're going to discuss this issue about the Christian and alcohol consumption. And I want to be honest and fair with you right now. I'm going to tell you right up front that the premise that I will work from is going to be that there is no room for alcohol in the life of a believer. I am for total abstinence from alcohol and any strong drink like that for a believer in Jesus Christ. Now, you say, well, I don't, you may not be. That's okay. I'm going to be honest though with you, and we're going to get deep into the scripture. We're going to find out and dissect the Hebrew, the language there, the Hebrew grammar, as well as the Greek. I'm going to be honest with you what it says. And I will also be honest with you and upfront with you, when, and I'll tell you, this is my thinking. If it's my opinion, I will say so. Now, you must understand that I'm loaded for bear on that. I've done my homework, and I hope you have. So please do not come up and start arguing with me about this Christian liberty thing. Well, doesn't Christian liberty from Romans 14 have anything to do with it? No. Yes. Well, what do you mean? No or yes? Not in the prominent way some people think. Yes, it's a factor, and we'll talk about how it fits into that. But the trouble is, people like to dwell on that Christian liberty part in chapter 14, but you fail to go to the entire context into chapter 15, where Jesus Christ made it very plain. He said that even Christ pleased not himself. So we have to think about that. So, but we're going to talk about it. We're going to find out, all right, where does this have, what place does it, or if it does, in the life of a Christian? We'll talk about it. We're going to talk about some other issues that can be kind of sticky. We're going to talk about some life issues. If you want 2019 and thereafter, however long we live before the Lord's return, as long as he tarries his coming. However, you know, that's a misnomer. The Lord's not tarrying his coming. It's set. We don't know. In fact, Jesus said only the Father in heaven knows. He's going to come when it's time to come. But to us from our side of the of eternity, it would seem like he's tarrying his coming. So as long as he tarries and he's not come, or as long as you are alive and live on this earth, let's make him some great years. So I'm going to challenge you with things this year. I want you to think on these things. I want you to be honest. I want you to be spiritual about it. And I want you to say, Pastor, I'm not sure that I agree with you, but I'm willing to give you an honest hearing. How many are willing to give me that? Amen. Okay. Think on these things. So, in the short time we have, what would you want us to think on today, Pastor Burkholder? All right, let's go to Luke chapter 4. Go to Luke chapter 4, verse 1. Now, you guys know the story here, don't you? It is the temptation of Christ. You say, well, why didn't you go to Matthew? Well, I could have gone to Matthew. But there are certain ways that Luke expresses this story, the way certain concepts, the way he presents them here, that I want to point out. So we'll look at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4. Are you there? Now notice, I want you to notice carefully. Now, folks, you cannot get out anything of the message unless your eyes are pouring over the script and you're looking at the scripture. It's like singing. Answer me, but don't answer me, but answer in your own heart. If I was to make you raise your hand, how many of you would raise your hand and say, well, no, I really don't sing during the worship service, during the song service. I just like to stand there and listen to all the good singing. Now, that is a pious gas bag if I've ever heard one. Do you know what that is? Well, he's like the Pharisees and the Sadducees of the New Testament. They're hypocrites. Oh, well, maybe you do like to hear that, and that's good. But you're missing the point about what worship is. Worship is your involvement. Isn't that right? Being involved? Folks, you're singing to God. Well, I just don't sing very good. Well, I'm sorry, but I don't believe that. But even if you don't think you're that good, and others agree that you're not that good, that should not stop you from singing to God and raising your voice in praise to him. You're honoring and glorifying and lauding him. Isn't that worth something to you? So the same thing applies here with Scripture. Look at your Bible. Follow. Listen carefully now to the words. Listen to the words and the phrases. Look how he puts these clauses together how he defines things. Look at verse 1. And Jesus, now carefully, you know, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan. What was Jordan? Jordan was a spiritual high. He was baptized, and the Spirit came down in the form of a dove, and they heard God's voice say, "This is my well-beloved chosen son. This is the one you need to listen to, because he's the chosen one. He's the anointed one that I've chosen to be your Savior." So that was a high, but he was full of the Holy Ghost. He returned from Jordan. Now watch, he was led by the Spirit. Now, do you get those two? He was full of the Holy Ghost. You know, to be full of something, it is to be controlled by it, to be consumed by it, it dominates you. Having the filling of the Holy Spirit is where he has control of your life. You're walking in the Spirit. But then, led by the Spirit. Yes, this is important, but wait, what does he do in leading Jesus? And he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Folks, I'm telling you that many times in our lives, even when we're really desiring to walk close to God and we're growing close to God and we have a good relationship with the Lord, there are still going to be times we're going to be in some wilderness territory. Now, here's the next verse. You notice that verse 1 ends with a comma. That means the thought continues. We don't want this paragraph to be broken up. So a part of that sentence, that he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness for what purpose? Being 40 days tempted of the devil. Now, have you put this together? Being full of the Holy Spirit, he was led by the Spirit, and he was led into... You know how Mark expresses this? Mark said the Spirit drove him into the wilderness. An impelling force. You must go. You do not have any other choice. That's the idea. Same way with Matthew. Now, Luke tells us, being 40 days, for 40 days, he was tempted of the devil. And in those days, he did eat nothing. All right, Matthew fills in and tells us he fasted. Now, Matthew doesn't say he was tempted for 40 days. It just means that he fasted for 40 days, and afterward he was hungry, and then the devil came to tempt him. Luke says, nah, he was doing battle with the devil for 40 days. Well, tell us. Now, Pastor, tell us, which is right? They're both right. Yes, Matthew is right, but Matthew is just concentrating. His viewpoint is just focusing on those three temptations that followed the time of fasting. Luke is going to pick that up, but he just brings out another point, that it was also during that 40 days Christ was doing battle and struggling, being tempted by the devil for 40 days, but all that's recorded here for us are these three particular temptations, because they're essential. And afterward he hungered. That means he was at his most vulnerable time. What is it that you want us to think on? I want you to think on this, folks. I want you to realize, I want to encourage you, I want to exhort you and lift you up right here. I don't want you to be discouraged when you're facing some real trying experiences in your life. I don't want you to be in despair. I don't want you to feel defeated. I don't want you to go around thinking something's wrong with me. I feel estranged from God. I'm trying to draw close to the Lord, but why won't the Lord hear my prayers? Why do I feel so far from God? Listen, that's one reason why we feel so far from God, because we've got the devil tugging at us. Jesus, was he right? Was he right with the Father? Yes, he was. Was he God? Yes. Well, what's Satan wants to trip Jesus up. Satan wants to tempt the Christ to prove he will sin, Satan wants to thwart God's plan of redemption. But that's okay. God sees this as an opportunity to prove to mankind, my son is sinless, and he is God. And it did prove to be true. So Jesus was not having trouble in his life. Jesus was not struggling with sin addiction, sinful habits. Jesus wasn't struggling. Jesus was on top of things, being full of the Holy Spirit, led by the Spirit, and then he faced this. I want you to understand, folks, listen. God has great opportunities for you. Don't be discouraged when in the time of great spiritual exercise, you face some real spiritual struggles. Now, it could be some of your struggles, some of your problems are coming because you're not doing right. Because you haven't given yourself to the Word of God. Do you know what would help you do that? Scripture memory. Do you guys memorize Scripture? You know, there were things during our ministry when we moved from Texas to North Carolina, there were some dark days. And I think the only thing that helped keep my mind, keep me from going berserk, was that I began to memorize Scripture. And it wasn't long before I had the entire book of Romans, James, 1 Peter, and Ephesians memorized. I memorized Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, the first two chapters of Luke. I memorized several chapters in Hebrews. I memorized the 119th Psalm and several other chapters there, and in Proverbs and Joshua and in Isaiah and several other passages. Boy, you must be smart. No, I had to struggle at memorizing. Anybody can memorize if you want to bad enough. How about this? What if in our bulletin, I don't have a bulletin up here, but what if in our bulletin that each week, Jennifer, we block off a little section, we make a little box, and let's call it higher ground. Those that want higher ground, and then each week, let's give a memory verse. And there's the memory verse for you to work on. Well, I can't do much at a time. Then take one verse and go with it. What I'm trying to encourage you is get your mind in the Word. Listen, you have enough television, and I guarantee you there's going to be some trouble. You get your mind filled with a lot. These kids that just consume themselves in front of these video games is ridiculous. Because that's robbing you of some essentials where you can think clearly. Now that's all there is to it. And the videos have been proven to be an open door to pornography. Not all of them, but it's an open door because there are certain habits and patterns formed through that that just is there to open the door. Doesn't mean you'll go through, doesn't mean you'll have a problem with, but there is a close link. Just keep that in mind. Put your mind in the Word. What I want to encourage you, think on this, that when you're facing some real spiritual trials, don't think that something's amiss between you and the Lord. It could be you're at your closest with the Lord and Satan is fighting you. All right, here's something else. Go to John 3:30. Here's something else I want you to think on. John chapter 3 and verse 30. Now, you know John chapter 3. You know, this was the conversation that Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews, came and he had with the Lord. And we know, of course, the Lord told Nicodemus, hey, unless you're born again, you can't enter into the kingdom of heaven. What? You mean a grown old man like me enter into my mother's womb and be born again? No. And he says, how do you do that, Nicodemus? How is it that you, being such a knowledgeable, educated man, you don't understand that? What's born of the spirit is spirit. That's the physical, the spiritual birth, the salvation. What's born of the flesh or of water? That's the physical birth. Obviously, you have to be born physically before you can be born again spiritually. But he says, I'm talking about what is from above. And then he gives us the famous verse we all know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Well, then after those things, boy, all the disciples begin to come to Jesus. Well, John was still busy baptizing, and some of his disciples said, whoa, John, what's going on here? I mean, they're all following him. Well, John answered in verse 27, said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. And you yourselves, guys, you knew. You heard me bear witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I'm sent before him. Well, what was John trying to say? Here it is, verse 30. Here it is, very simple. He must increase, but I must decrease. Isn't that something? What does he mean by that? He was telling his disciples, he was telling them simply, friends, he said, I must become less important. He must become greater in importance. He becomes greater and more important. I become less important. He must become more prominent in my life. And I must become little. I must become less prominent. I become less significant. I must. That's an imperative. It's binding. In other words, he literally says, this man, Jesus, whom you're talking about, it is necessary, it is binding that he gain the prominence and that people look to him and flock to him. And it is equally binding and necessary that I fade into the background. Because I want people to see Jesus. That's what John was happy at that. And that's what I want you to think on. If you're going to have some victory and success in 2019, if we are as a church, Jesus has got to become more important and significant to you than he is right now in your life. You have got to become little. Do you know what Paul's name is? Well, his first name was Saul, and then it was changed. You read it in the book of Acts. Saul means the mighty one. But then his name was changed to Paul. Why? Because Paul means the little one. If we're going to have some victory, if we're going to have a healthy church and ministry, if you're going to have a healthy Christian walk with God, you have got to become less important. Your desires, your thinking must fade in the background. Basically, what this is saying, he has got to be glorified and honored in my life. He has got to be prominent in my attitude, my moods, my outlook, my perception, my judgments. His thoughts must dominate me. His spirit must dominate me. His plans have got to dominate my thinking, not my plans. My plans need to fade into non-existence. Do you remember the sermon Steve Keith preached last week? Hey, you remember him saying, don't put God in your plans. Steve, what are you saying? Oh, he said, put yourself in God's plans. It's pretty good. What this John 3:30 meant, let me paraphrase it. God's plans must have greater control over me, and my plans must fade into non-existence. There, that's kind of a way to do it, isn't it? Christ grows in prominence and importance in my heart. I fade into the back. Me, self, my self-absorbed, I'm being self-absorbed, my selfishness, everything about me, that fades into the background. I want you to think on that. Now, we go back to Philippians 4 and verse 8. Now listen, whatsoever, my brethren, whatsoever things are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, of good report, there be any virtue, any praise, think on these things. Now, we'll talk about what those terms mean later. But listen to the verse. Think on these things. What do you think it takes to do that? That phrase, think on these things, it implies work. Kids, you go to school. You know what? You want good grades, you want to learn, it's going to take work. I had a German teacher when I took German in high school. I took German, I took several years of Spanish, I've taken Hebrew and Greek. And I'm going to tell you, it's work. Don't you think thinking, wait a minute, it takes work. That means I've got to make some effort. Do you know what else that implies? Think on these things. That means I've got to discipline myself. It implies as I face trial, as I face challenges, I'm going to have to learn new thought patterns. I'm going to have to learn new ways of how to respond. Do you have the tendency of flying off the handle and losing your temper? Then you're going to have to figure out new ways to think different, new thought patterns. You're going to have some new habits. Quit cutting yourself so much slack. That's a lot of the problem now. We've got congressmen, politicians, and they make rules for us, and then they're involved in graft and payoffs and briberies. Sexual rendezvous, lust, it dominates them. Quit cutting so much slack here. This is home plate. That batter sets up to here. That means that pitcher, is this right, Tom? This is 17 inches. Now, Tom, answer me this. You're a pitcher. And you're going to pitch. Where are you going to put the ball? Right here? Over the plate? Now, that's just 17 inches. Can you do that? Hey, Tom, no problem. No problem. Do you need it wider? Hey, we can make it 19. Would that help you? In fact, I'll tell you what. If that's not good enough, Tom, don't worry about it. We'll make home plate 25 inches. Would that help you? Okay. No problem. No problem. Hey, we'll make it whatever you want. What happens when businessmen lose all sense of ethical value? They have no ethics. Hey, no problem. We'll just make a wider home plate for you. That's all. You got to get it here, but no problem. So old Tom here, he comes to practice and he's late. And then he's late again. No problem. We've given you a wider home plate. Don't worry about it. You're here. Get here when you can. There used to be a rule in baseball, no facial hair. Here comes old Tom, just Grizzly. We start calling him Grizzly. No problem, because we've widened home plate for it. We're going to give you more latitude. That's okay. Think about this up like this as a house. There's the problem. Parents, you're not disciplining your kids. You're just making the home plate wider for them. That's exactly what you're doing. Some of you that have a hard time, picture this as the church. Oh, I tell you what the problem is. Everybody wants church at their convenience. You come when you want. How do you expect to train and mentor your children about what faithfulness and dedication to the Lord, of what He is increasing and you're decreasing? If, hey, no problem, kids, stay home. We'll just give you a wider home plate to work with. That's the trouble with education. That's why our school teachers are about to pull their hair out and go crazy. That's why a lot of them are leaving the profession by droves. Why? Oh, because we're just gonna give them a wider berth. We've taken the ability of the teachers to have discipline out of their hands. No much wonder there's such trouble in these schools. We have a mom and a dad that are not home most of the time. We just, give me more latitude, give me more of this. Don't talk to me about my tithes and my offerings. Okay, I'll give you your birth, don't worry about it. See, we want to relax the rules. Folks, do you honestly believe with all your heart that because we're under grace, grace doesn't have any commands? If you think that, you are inexcusably naive. And it's inexcusable that you would think that just because we're under grace, that grace still doesn't have its laws and its commands. You tell me what this is. Jesus said, do not commit adultery. But I'm telling you, if you just lust in your heart after a woman, you're guilty of adultery. I think that raises the law up to a higher level, don't you? I think there's still a command there. Well, I'm not guilty of murder. No, but you hate your brother without cause. You're guilty of murder. Seems like grace still has its commands, does it not? And by the way, he said, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse that my house may be full. And he also said equally in 1 Corinthians 16 that on the first day of the week, let every man lay aside in store in the treasury the first day of the week of that which God hath prospered him. That means the first goes to the Lord. Now let's not worry so much about a 10% or a 5% or a 15%. What he's after is your heart. What he's after is your dedication. He doesn't want to give you how does this thing work? Oh, there we go. He doesn't want to give you a wider berth. No, he's given you the parameters. Now aim for it and go for it. He's not going to keep cutting you slack. Well, I had this episode in my life. Well, I had a rough childhood. Well, I was abused. I don't know how many times. I saw the story of a boy that went through that. Deep abuse and rejection by his own parents. He rose to be a successful businessman and motivational speaker. You don't have to be dominated and controlled and defined by your past and by those things. God's not going to give you a wider home plate. Tom, I'm sorry, buddy. I like you, but you're going to have to zero in. You're going to have to follow this, and you're going to have to get that ball right across the plate. Now, you're going to have to be determined. I'm going to do it. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. But I tell you what, it's not going to work, folks. If you start playing Russian roulette with church attendance, with church service, with loving the Lord, with your Bible reading, it won't work. I mean, you're going to have to figure out some new disciplines, some new patterns of living. Many times in my ministry, I had to be up to the church early in the morning. Susan, she got all three kids ready and got to church. Well, what did she do when one of them was sick? Stayed home with it, and I brought the other two. What if she was sick? I brought the kids. What if I was sick? I came anyway. I can't tell you how many times I had bronchitis and fever, and I still stood in that pulpit and I preached. You say, isn't that kind of foolish? Well, maybe it is. Maybe it is. But what I'm trying to point out, every one of you has enough time and enough money and enough know-how to do what you want to do. But when it comes to being here on time for church, it just seems like we want a wider home plate. Do we not? I don't have anything to apologize for, but I don't want to offend anybody. But I'm just wondering, what does Christ mean to you? What has he done for you that's made you turn on him? You're not turning on me. You're not turning on the church. You're turning on the Lord. Now, I realize there are times when we're providentially hindered and so forth. I was talking to old Brother Jeff Kolonowski. He's talking about his mother being in the hospital last week. We understand those. Those are not the things I'm talking about. I'm talking about when we can be here, we won't be here. And yet, you guys will drag yourselves out of bed and you'll be there to work. And you'll be on time. If you're not on time, it's gonna cost you. Do any of you parents just let your... I know You let your kids just stay home when they don't feel like going to school, don't you? No, they go to school. I had a friend one time, lots of days, her daughter was late. I mean, past the first or second hour. Missed a lot of the school. Well, she was just tired. I thought she needed to sleep some more. My boys did that one time. Well, I don't feel like it. Oh, it's a feeling you want. Well, okay. Out of bed, I'll give you a good warm feeling. You say, you were an old meanie. That's what Josh, you know, the one that came here and preached? Yeah, that's what he, you're an old meanie. I said, son, you ever been to the moon? You're fixing to go. No, we make sure they're there. If your kids have a job, you make sure that they're there and they're on time. Oh, isn't God just as important? Now, I know there are circumstances that exist from time to time. I know that. I can understand that. I'm not getting on that. I'm talking about when there is no reason for us to be hindered, but we hinder ourselves. Is he increasing in your life or decreasing? Are you increasing or are you decreasing? You may feel today that you are struggling. Then be encouraged. When you do right, Satan doesn't like it and he's going to attack you. But it's going to take discipline and effort on our part to think on these things. And it takes that. If I'm going to, don't you realize what these elements represent? It represents a man that was willing to put himself out there to die on Calvary's tree for us. I think it's worth my decreasing and him increasing. And I think it's also time, if you will think on these things, would you give me an honest hearing? I think you did. Thank you for it. Now, would you stand with your heads bowed and eyes closed? We're going to have a brief song here. It's really kind of a simple chorus, okay? A simple chorus. I have decided to follow Jesus. Is that what we got, Dick? It's what we got. All right, now I'm going to give you the opportunity to search your heart and say, Lord, I need to be right with you. If I'm going to partake of these elements, I need to be right with you. Here's your opportunity. And I give you that today. Father, I pray the blessings of this word of God and this message upon these people. I mean, however frail with feigned lips that it was, I pray, God, that you'll just move upon the hearts of the people and encourage them to want to draw closer to you. I pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen. He's going to lead us on verse or two here of this song. Page 434. I have decided to follow Jesus. Okay, friend, would you do that as we prepare for the communion and we have this invitation time? Here it is. Will you come? On this first, I have decided to follow Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided.
I'll carry.
may be seated. Thank you. You may be seated. Today in the benevolence offering, we'll go to the benevolence fund. I want to read from Matthew's version of that time of temptation. Some people have wondered, well, why was Luke's order of the three temptations different than Matthew? Because Matthew gave it chronologically. Luke gave a logical format, kind of climactic in that way, to heighten some the intensity of what Christ was feeling. But it says here, Jesus was led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. See, he's clear. He said, this is the purpose. This is the reason. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he hungered. And when the tempter came, he said, well, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. And he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. He was just simply saying, yes, food is necessary, but there are other things more necessary than that. And it's necessary that I see that I'm within the will of God, that for God to supply my need. I'm not going to go outside the will of God to do that. And what he does, he quotes, the three temptations were taken from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, one from chapter 8 and two from chapter 6. So he quotes them. That's all he could do. That's all we can do. So I think about that. Make these stones bread. Yet, I think about the bread that he took. He took the bread. He broke it and he blessed it and he passed it. He said, this bread is the living bread. This bread gives you life. If you don't eat of me, you can't have eternal life. Eat your flesh? No. This is the true bread. He was speaking, of course, in a spiritual sense. And so he said, this is the bread that will give you life, because I have given my life for you. And so when Jesus faced that temptation, he was saying, if we could paraphrase here, Satan, I'm going to the cross. There'll be a time for this bread, but I'm going to do it within the will of the Lord. And he said, I came to do the will of him that sent me. And what was that will? To die for you and me. This bread represents life. Jesus broke it and said, take, eat of this is my body, which is given to you. He blessed it, and then they partook of it. Brother Don, would you lead us in prayer? You know, next, Satan took the Lord to a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world, said, if you'll bow down and worship me, all this can be yours. Well, someday it's going to be the Lord's anyway. And had he done that, there would have been no blood shed for us. But again, he came to do the will of him that sent him. And the Lord said, only the Lord is who you worship and serve. And what he did by doing that to the Father gave us this that represents his blood that was shed for us. What a blessing to know that when we're under the blood, no longer can he see our sins. Brother Jim, would you lead us? We have right now our benevolence offering. If you'll stand, as our ushers then will pass the plates, the benevolence offering today will go into the benevolence fund. And as we play here and pass the plate,